Hi, I'm Dave with ATech Training. What I'd like to do today is give you a walkthrough of our Model 1351 air conditioning trainer. This particular unit is based on a 2006 Buick LaCrosse, and it's broken down as a trainer into three primary sections. There is, of course, the refrigerant section. There is electronic control section with the control head that operates the intake air temperatures and the doors and the blower speeds. And then there is this addition that we put on it, the electronic controllers that allows us to put faulting in it for the students to practice their diagnostics on real systems. So with that, let's get started with the refrigerant section. As with any air conditioning system, we need to begin with the free refrigeration process. Now on this trainer, because obviously this compressor is not connected to an engine, we have to drive it with an electric motor. You can see down here, it's driven with a serpentine belt into the compressor. This is a 220 motor, so you're going to operate this trainer, you're going to have access to a 220 volt supply. Also to operate this trainer, you're going to need to have a 12 volt supply. This is the power source for the control head and the motors and such. It also activates the control clutch on the front of the compressor, which is still active. Now, beginning with the compressor, as we do with any air conditioning system, the compressor is going to put out a high pressure gas. The high pressure gas is going to feed through this hose and into the condenser. Because this is a thermostatic expansion valve type system, it would also use a receiver dryer. Now, this particular unit does not have a separate receiver dryer canister. In fact, instead what it does is on the end of the condenser down here, you can see it's got a tube that runs down the length of the condenser height-wise, and that's got the desiccant in it. So as refrigerant comes in here, as a low pressure gas, or a high pressure gas, I'm sorry, goes through the condenser, it gets not only its cooling in the condenser to turn it into a liquid, but it also goes through the receiver over there, and what it will do is dry the refrigerant as it comes through. Coming out of the condenser, it would feed through this high pressure line past the high pressure sensor that the electronics, the PCM would look at the signal that comes out of this high pressure sensor in case if the pressure in the system gets too high, the PCM can control the way the engine operates. It can control the injection pulse width, or it can shut the air conditioning compressor off altogether. Coming past that, we of course go into our cap. This is where our high pressure gauge would feed in. Also, we've added this is obviously not included on most air conditioning systems. What we did is we put a lever actuated ball valve in here. Now when this ball valve is in line with this refrigerant line here, it will allow the refrigerant to pass. You can, however, turn this lever up to 90 degrees perpendicular to the line. When you do, what that will do is that will block off increasingly amounts of refrigerant and cause it to back up in the system. That allows it to simulate a blockage inside one of the lines, and the effect would be seen between the gauges on the high pressure and the low pressure side. You need to be aware that this ball valve does, though, have a hole drilled through it. And the reason for that is in case there was ever an incident where somebody happened to overcharge this system, having that small hole in there would allow it to alleviate pressure and not back it up and cause problems, possibly damaging the compressor. As we move on through here, our high pressure liquid comes into our thermostatic expansion valve, and from there it would feed into the evaporator, which of course is in this case we can't see. It would go from a high pressure liquid into a low pressure liquid. It absorbs heat in the evaporator, turns into a low pressure gas, comes back through this tube. You've got your low pressure cap here where your gauge would connect to that, and then of course it feeds back into the compressor and the cycle starts all over again. Also on this side, I want you to see there's a switch here. This is to turn the compressor on. There's a key switch here that would be just like the ignition and the switch, which would power the control head. And also over here, there's a couple of other features you need to be aware of as we go forward. This first one is the ambient temperature sensor, which just measures the outside temperature. Because this is a smart system, it's an automatic system, it senses the internal temperature, the external temperature, and this other sensor here is sun load. Temperatures outside can be the same, but if the sun is out, obviously there's a great deal of heat load that you wouldn't have to deal with if it were dark, but the temperature was the same. So this sun load sensor will detect how much light there is from the heat. There is another sensor here. This is the inside air temperature sensor, and this has a control we've built into it with several positions. You can go in and dial up different temperatures for your intake air temp sensor, and that would tell the control head that the conditions were a certain way, regardless of what they actually were. By doing that, you could manipulate the controls to make it operate in a certain fashion. It has On the right side, there's a position called ACT, actual. In actual position, it will operate out of the actual reading of this intake air temp sensor. Anything that you select off of that, 100 degrees, 70 degrees, 35 degrees, whatever, will feed a different signal into the control head and it will operate accordingly. Now, let's go into the electronic control system. On this side of the trainer, there's some electrical features I'd like to point out. There's a series of relays here that you can see. This first is, of course, the ignition relay. This is tied into the key. This is the one that provides power to the control head, to the motor packs, and such as that. There's an AC compressor relay. This would normally be controlled by a PCM. It controls the clutch on the compressor. Obviously, this unit doesn't have a PCM. We'll get into that in a bit. And then there are three fan relays here. This is a pretty typical three-relay, two-speed fan operation. This unit has got two cooling fans back here. The condenser, it operates them off of three relays. The first relay is always on, and it provides low speed for both fans. It runs the two in series, and so they run at low speed. And then the PCM, when need be, it will kick on these second and third relay, and that supplies 12-volt power to both, and they run at high speed. Now, the AC compressor relay, as well as all three of the fan relays, typically operate out of the PCM. This particular unit does not have a PCM. That's part of what's in this box down here. What we did, we used the actual control head to operate these features, but some of the things that would require PCM interaction, we've been able to simulate in this box down here so as to reduce the cost of the unit. But it operates under the same conditions and at the same time as it would if it had a PCM. Notice here as well, you can see one of the motors that operates this door in here, and we'll get to those in just a second. On the front side of this trainer, I'd like to point out some of the control features. This box that I mentioned a while ago, this is the electronic control circuit we put in it to simulate the PCM operation. It's also our interface for communication. There are two connections here. One is a Cat5, the other is USB. You can use either when you connect into this to attach it to the IMP program so that you can fault remotely and monitor what the students are doing diagnostically. There's also a power supply mounted here. Now, this is normally not a part of the air conditioning system. This power supply is the one that we use to supply feed into the faulting boxes we have mounted up here. We'll get into those in a second. You also notice in this the case here, we've got two sensors. Because this is a dual zone system, it has two intake air sensors to tell you the driver's side and the passenger side temperatures, and those are located here. We have a data link connector where you can plug in a scan tool and do your diagnostics, either pull codes out of it or do bi-directional controls of the motors and the actuators and such. This is the actual control head for the unit. It's typically an automatic system. Like I said earlier, it's dual zone. You can operate it in manual mode, and you can see you've got the controls on each side for the driver's side and the passenger side. There are two seat heater controls here. Sorry, no seat heater included. But you can see you've got all the controls here for a fan speed, for a defroster, defogger, recirculation door, and then, of course, the directions for bidirectional or lower heater control direction on the motors. Also on this, you can see we've got in here the recirculation. We can see the recirculation door on this side. There are two other door actuators we can see in here that give us both our frontal airflow and our bidirectional airflow. The last thing I'd like to point out on this particular trainer is the addition of these two boxes up here. This is what allows us to simplify diagnostics and to interface with the unit. You notice in this box, what we've done is we've gone in and put in test points. Each of these test points allows a student to come in with a digital meter or with an oscilloscope or whatever test equipment you're using and go in and make tests on the different electronic devices in this trainer without going in and back probing the connectors. As you know, if you have to get a series of classes, everybody comes in and back probes, the pins of the connectors won't last very long. This allows longevity on the trainer. You notice under each of these test points, there is a number. Each of those numbers coincides directly with the circuit numbers that are included in the actual OEM electrical schematics, so the students can follow those as well. Notice in this board, this box over here, there's an LCD display that gives us a readout here. There is a keypad. Down here, this is a fuse that supplies power, protects this in case of an overpower condition, and then the power switch, the on-off power switch. Again, this unit is powered from the supply that we saw on the front earlier. With this side, we got one of two options. Either we can go in and fault it what's called locally. The students can go in, for instance, if they wanted to use fault number one, you'd hit one and pound, it would insert a fault into this trainer. The students would then do their diagnostics, and once they got their solution, what they found the problem to be, they could clear that fault and go on to the next one from there. Or the other possibility is this allows us to connect remotely to the instructor management program via PC. By doing that, we can not only send faults remotely, but the students can come in, log in using this keypad with their student ID, and as the students go through, the instructor can send faults to them, the students will do their diagnosis, and under that scenario, you have the ability not only to track the student's progress as they go through, but also to keep track of all the diagnostic troubleshooting that they've done. Well, that's the ATech Model 1351 air conditioning trainer in a nutshell. I thank you for joining me today. If you have any additional questions about this trainer, its capabilities or availability, please feel free to contact us at 859-485-7229 or on the web at atechtraining.com. Thank you.